Hi, this is Tom Rhodes. Please join me as I scour the four corners of the earth to bring you interesting and intelligent, funny people who will enrich your life with wisdom and laughter. I'll take you to Europe, Australia, all over America. I might take you to the peaks of Machu Picchu, the canals of Amsterdam, the Great Wall of China, or the swamps of Florida, and certainly the many, many comedy clubs and comedy theaters all over the world. Come hang out with me and meet the many interesting people that pop up in my life as I travel the world as a stand-up comedian.
You're listening to Tom Rhodes Radio.
Karate kick, baby.
Rock and roll.
Ian Edwards, ladies and gentlemen. Ian Edwards.
What's up, T?
Hey, man. I'm not bullshitting you when I say you're one of my favorite comedians.
Oh, thanks, man.
And one of the, I think, one of the most gifted comedy writers I've ever known or witnessed in my lifelong love of comedy.
Are you serious? That's a huge statement. But because I want to learn from that statement, explain to me why. Even though it's gonna sound like you're praising me more.
Well, and I'm not like kissing your ass, you know. Right. I mean, you can listen back to all the other episodes. I do have a tendency to praise, but every time I see you, your jokes are so well written, but you just raise the bar up every time I see you. When I saw you a couple weeks ago in Venice, you know, you're talking about the bit you're doing about the Charleston shooting.
Right, right.
Which
right.
is, come on, I mean, how can you make that funny? I've tried to talk about it on stage, and which is my true feeling of that event. But that was one of the most horrendous events in American history. Nothing has affected me that deeply to my core since September 11th.
Oh,
and you've got, like, the definitive joke about it.
Oh, thanks, man. I mean, I'm sorry the event happened that I had to come up with the joke, but it happened. And I can do about it, so I might as well just create something funny. There's always something silly and something serious, so it's always great to find it and then hear your peers like it. So that's good.
But your kind of style and your rhythm of speaking on stage, like, you can talk about black and white issues without being the angry black man.
Right, right, right.
Or I don't know how to describe that with in a softer way. But it's palatable.
Right, right, right.
To talk about uncomfortable subjects, which I think is, like, the most masterful thing that you can do in comedy, is to take something horrendous and unfunny that affects everyone's lives and is in everyone's psyches and find the truth of solutions for humanity,
right?
Shall we say.
Yeah. I think I learned that a while ago through, like, a lot of trial and error. I like angry comedy, but if you have a hard message, I learned that it's ineffective to deliver it hard. Like, tone is very important, and it's a good thing I'm a laid back, lazy person anyway. Some people say laid back, I say lazy. And then I was figuring, if you say things, you don't have to say things the way they sound. And then, you know, just being a fan of, like, Bob Marley and studying how, like, he delivered his message. Like, a lot of people have had Bob Marley's message and played music and delivered it, but his way was the most effective way, just because it was palatable, like you just said. You know what I'm saying? Like, he just knew how to do it, and I always noticed that.
I read a great Bob Marley quote recently where he said,
turn this off.
The people who want to do evil in the world never take a day off, so why should I?
I know, right?
Yeah, you should move that way. Well, you're the first comedian that ever used Bob Marley as an influence.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm Jamaican, so, like, I grew up listening to him, so.
Are you Jamaican?
Yeah, yeah. Like, my parents are Jamaican. I was born in England, lived there till I was 9, and then we moved to Jamaica when I was 9 and lived there till I was 17. And just, my older cousin Jennifer, who I always looked up to, like we'd go up to her house, and like her mother was my mother's sister, older sister. So we used to go over there in England. She'd be gone. She'd have all these posters in her room. We'd be playing in her room with her younger sisters, and we'd play her records and stuff. And then my parents would play. Just you know, back then, you know, Bob Marley. Back then, now he's a killer. You know,
all-time perennial.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, so being born in England, and then living part of your childhood in Jamaica, and then going to New York, how did you avoid having either of these three definitive accents?
Well, England was nine. So when you get to Jamaica, you're young. It was easy to just start talking patois, broken English. And, you know, I got cousins. We live with them and just people. Like, they could still tell. You know, like, my nickname was English in Jamaica. In Jamaica, they just call you what you are.
Because you are from England.
Yeah. like, this is a Chris Spencer joke, but it's he's Jamaican, too. So it's like, if you're in Jamaica and you have one arm, they just call you Oney. You know what I'm saying? If you have one eye, they just call you One Eye. You know, it's what you are. So my nickname was English. And so they could tell, you know. And then, and then coming to America, like in high school, I wanted to kind of ditch the Jamaican accent for the wrong reason. Just to acclimate and not to get made fun of by the American kids who outnumbered us.
What's cooler and more exotic than having a Jamaican accent, though? Especially in New York.
You're right, but back then, it wasn't always cool. You know, like, things become cool. But, you know, like, I hung out with the Jamaican kids only, but I just didn't want to stand out that way other places. You know what I mean? So I got caught up the wrong way a little bit, and like, and plus, especially when I started doing stand up, I didn't think the accent served me. Like, I did Jamaican characters in my act, but I wanted to connect with the audience. So then I was like, I did work a lot on my American accent, or not sounding as Jamaican as I did.
Where in New York were you?
I was in Long Island.
Okay.
And the city for comedy.
I was conceived in Jamaica.
Get the hell out of here. That's hilarious. You know what? A lot of people were.
But it's a great story. My father and mother were on vacation in Kingston, and my mom's luggage was lost by the airline.
Very common.
With her birth control pills.
Oh, snap.
And my parents were staying at the Kingston Sheraton. Mm-hmm. And this is 1966, and it was the one and only time that Haile Selassie visited Jamaica. Uh-huh. And he was also staying at the Kingston Sheraton at the same time. And my dad described it to me that there were just thousands of Jamaican people surrounding the hotel, trying to, like, just get a glimpse of Haile Selassie.
Yeah.
And my father actually wanted to name me Kingston Sheraton.
That would have been crazy. So your name was Kingston Sheraton.
I'm already pretty arrogant, so I mean, that's, I think,
it's hilarious.
A name like Kingston really would have put it over.
Yeah,
the top.
That's funny, Kingston Sheraton. You was conceived in Jamaica. That's bananas, man.
I've never been there. I would love to go.
Never been there. Just created there.
Mm-hmm.
That's funny. You should go. You should go back to your homeland. I knew this. I always liked you. I didn't know why. Now I know. Now I know why. Yeah. We're this close. Yeah.
So I watched this fantastic Conan O'Brien clip of you, and again, you know, your level of material, like the stuff about the black men wearing hoodies, and it's men and white men in suits that have done most of the big robberies,
right?
And the news has you afraid of people in hoodies, but you should really fear, like, white men in suits. Just absolute brilliant slabs of material.
Thanks, man.
I was in Berkeley, California, a couple years ago, and in the main square there was a bunch of black young teenagers with hoodies, and they're huddled over. And, you know, your first thought is, man, you know, what are they selling drugs? Are they shooting dice over there? And I got a little closer, and they were playing chess.
Oh, damn, that's funny.
The only violence was he took his rook.
Taking it. The cop shoot him for that. He took his rook. Yeah, I just want people just got it twisted, man. Like, the media is so dishonest, and there's certain politicians that really, like, they used to pretend to be honest. Now they don't even care. Like, they realize how much more they can just get away with straight out lying. So it's just like, sometimes I just want to interject and throw my little thing in there just to, like, you know, maybe it'll help. You know, maybe, you know, like, you know, it's just, everything's just so unfair, man. So as long as you're going to be unfair, I might as well try to do something, say something, point something out, you know. So that's what I like doing, like, being a contrarian. Yeah, like, so many things that are, like, known sayings and thoughts and beliefs, they're just completely inaccurate. And we've been just going with these things for so long. And it's like, yeah, just fuck it.
I like mixed race girls. Are you mixed? Who said that? Oh, the Asian chick?
Yeah. Okay.
What do you mix with?
German.
German, all right. I got nothing to add to that. She's just an Asian chick, half German, half Asian. It's cute. Mixed race girls are always fine. It don't matter who the parents are. Could be the two ugliest people from each race. They will have the finest daughters, you know what I'm saying? They would combine their unfortunate-looking powers together and have the finest daughters. Like, every time you see a mixed-race girl, you'd be looking at them in disbelief, like, oh, my gosh, shorty, you are off the chain. You mean to tell me that Lil Wayne and Susan Boyle are your parents? This your homegirl? Wow. You're a dime for real, for real. You mean to tell me that Smeagol from The Lord of the Rings and the woman who shot Selena are your parents? Fine, shit. Damn, Simon, you got to be the baddest one of them all. You are so fine. You are preposterously fine. You mean to tell me that the ShamWow guy and the girl from the movie Precious?
Oh, no.
Here goes to all ladies. Oh, man, did we all not see the same movie? Because the movie I saw, she looked like the dude from The Blind Side.
What about this year, 2015? This has been, just the news just has been more preposterous than ever. But especially in the United States, it seems like it's open hunting season on black males.
Mm-hmm.
And then the horrendous thing in Charleston happened. The thing that really struck me that I tried to talk about on stage was the fact that these people stood there,
mm-hmm,
in that courtroom less than 24 hours later and forgave that uneducated, jobless, swamp turd and meant it.
Uh-huh.
So, like, that had such a... So I thought, you know, I want to try to forgive, and people that I haven't right. forgiven in my life, you oh, know, shit. And you can meditate on it and you can think about it.
Right.
But, and then, like, you know, like in traffic, someone would be a, you know, cut you off or whatever. And I was like, I forgive you. And like, I was just trying to implement this. It's hard.
Yeah, it's not
easy. Have you ever tried to be forgiving?
Yeah.
There's new people to hate every day.
Yeah, this shit ain't easy. Like, I even have this new bit about I like not liking the people that I don't like. You know what I'm saying? And the thing that makes me and my friends closer is that we don't like the same people, and we get together and we trash them. And it's like going to a restaurant and picking the people we don't like off the menu and sharing them with each other. And forgiving is tough. You know, it's something I'm just still working on. You know, it's really tough. But, you know, so shit, a mad respect for those people that went in that church and forgave the shooter afterwards, you know? I couldn't do it.
Impossible.
Forgiving is not an ability, not a great ability of mine. Like, you know, I wish I was better at it, but it's not.
Who do you and your friends hate? Is it like comedians or just
other comics or politicians or movies? We hate on anything. You could hate on any movies. Not even hating, just be critical of like movies, TV shows, jokes, anything. You know, just have a fun time trashing shit. You know, just for the heck of it. Let off some steam. It's therapeutic. Why not?
Yeah. I was also impressed that the Conan, what is it, Team Coco Records?
Yeah, yeah.
You were the first comedian that that they put out an album for?
Right, right.
And so you're, what is it, 100% half-assed?
Yeah, 100% half-assed, yeah.
I mean, you've got street credibility within comedy, unparalleled to most comedians.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
I mean, as a writer, as a thinker, you know what I'm saying? I mean, and that's why I've always liked you. I mean, I've always thought that you brought like a level of intelligence that you don't see. I mean, you know, you can make jokes that you know you think you're lazy, but in my perspective, you know, in comedy, you're anything but lazy because there's so much laziness in comedians doing, and I've been guilty of it myself, doing you know, going for the easy laugh or the cheap thing, where it seems like you always try and take it to like a higher place.
Yeah, I mean, it's 'cause I guess it's part of like the way I was comedy raised. I was comedy raised on like Bill Cosby, Richard Pryor, you know, some Eddie Murphy, and just great storytellers and people who put stuff together. And I wasn't always this good. It was a struggle to get to the level that I'm at now, and it's a struggle to stay at that level. And I say I'm lazy because sometimes I don't write when I know I could write, you know, and you know, I'm very critical of myself too. So, you know, those things keep pushing me. I mean, it ain't always healthy to be critical of yourself.
Yeah.
But I know, I don't know what I'd be like if I wasn't. So I'd rather, I know I'll try to keep a certain standard if I am, you know, so then I just stay that way. But I mean, and I like hearing comics say, you know, like you or just anybody that I respect saying, hey man, I think you're really funny. Like that's like lines like that just keep you alive and keep you going and let you know you're on the right path. You know what I mean?
Well, yeah. I mean, you've always been like kind of like a quiet storm. You know, like there's some comedians that like you're backstage or in the green room and you know they're all like, you know, just loud or just kind of being all kind of puffed up, like you know, I'm the king shit or whatever. Mm-hmm. And you've never been like a really kind of arrogant, boastful guy. You just kind of mellow, and then you just go out and rip the place to shreds. You didn't stick around that show at the Comedy Underground in Venice.
Oh, in Venice, right, right.
When I saw you a couple weeks ago, you went on early in the show.
Right, and I think I had another spot or something.
Destroyed the place, and then the show wasn't the same after
that. Oh, for real?
Because, you know, once you have an orgasm, you don't want to keep having sex.
Oh, yeah, that's like funny.
It was like the audience, oh, all right, we got what we came for.
You know, I mean, you know, I mean, I like that. What can I say? I like that. You know, it's just, you know, just gotta. I'm not where I want to be. I don't have what I want to have. I don't know if I'll be happy when I have the things that I think I want to have, but I'd like to at least get there and be like, this is good, and it feels the way I expect it to feel, or this ain't shit. I can't believe. At least I'll have a good track record of material and hard work. And some money when I do it. So, you know, I just got to chase these goals and try to make it happen, man.
What do you want out of this business?
Just some good retirement fuck you money that I never have to worry about working again. Even if something goes bad in the world or you get sued or just some ill shit happens, just have enough money to be like, I can chill, you know. And I want to be able to eat wherever I want to eat. And if I want to help some people, I want to be able to help some people. And I just want to be able to be old and take care of myself. You know what I'm saying? So just want to be, you know, lifetime financially stable.
What about artistically?
Artistically, that's the route I'm taking to get there. You know what I'm saying? That's the route. Artistically, you know, I'd like to have a show. You know, I got a good show idea, and I'd like to, like, tour based on that show. I'd like to have a Louis-ish, Chris Rock-ish style type career, like, produce some shit that I'm in and do some drama and comedy. Like, I'm getting to do it now. You know, I was just in a movie called Tangerine. It was like, it happened by kind of like, almost like an accident. Like, the dude, Sean Baker, the director, it wasn't even him that I ran it with. His producer was at the store. And they'd seen me in New York, and they saw me at the store, and said, hey, I'm shooting this movie. Do you want to be in it? I'm like, whatever. You hear that. It's L.A. You hear that a lot.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh, my God. Every, you know, if you had a dollar for every time somebody came up to you after a show in Los Angeles, went, man, right. I got a part or a thing, mm-hmm. and you'd be perfect in.
Like that happens only one out of 99 times. Is that ever going to go down? So I was like, all right. And before that, like a few months before, I said, you know what, I want to act more. Like, I just kind of meditated and, like, got in that mode. I said, I want to act more. And they called me, and they was like, we're shooting on Saturday. They emailed me a script. Not that Saturday, but a few Saturdays later. It was in February. And even that night, I was hanging out the Friday night before at this big show at the comedy club in the movie theater on over by Man's Chinese Theater.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And I was even contemplating, should I go in? Should I go to this thing? It's like some bullshit throwaway thing. So nah, people ask you to act in something. The Hollywood ain't giving you shit. Why would you turn down the people who would give you some shit?
Right.
So I was like, yeah, I'll go. And woke up in the morning, went down to this taco stand in East Hollywood, and they had iPhones. They were shooting this thing on iPhones.
They were shooting it on iPhones.
Oh, yeah, they were shooting on iPhones. And I'm like... But the thing that caught me is, like, somebody said this line a long time ago. When you're shooting something, once they capture it on film, it's there forever. So I, like, I want this shit to be good. You know, I want people to have this bad footage of me, like, just around. I have no control of it. So I just committed to it. And I didn't know what this thing was. And then they shot it on an iPhone. But I took it serious. And then I forgot about it. Then it hit me in November of last year, and the guy was like, left a message, and I didn't recognize the number. And then I called back. He didn't answer. I left a message. Then I checked the message, and he's like, this is Sean Baker from the movie that they did called Tangerine. Now, when I shot the movie didn't have a name. Also, I didn't know if it was a short or a feature. I just did that scene, those scenes that day. So then, I don't know what's going on. He calls me back and he tells me, and while he's telling me about the name of the movie and describing it to me and telling me that we're getting into Sundance, but don't tell anybody, I'm like, I don't remember none of this shit. And I was like, oh, the iPhone movie? And he said, yeah. So then he reminds me that I said that. You said
that. And don't tell anybody that either.
Yeah. So there's it. And don't tell. And the movie sold at Sundance and got into the theaters. You know, Magnolia Pictures picked it up and the Duplass Brothers, and it got into theaters. And I think somebody just saw it the other day and saw me. So it's like, I'm just trying to, so I'm doing some of the things that I want to do, and I just want to do more.
What is the part, and what was the movie about?
Tangerine is about, it's a crazy weird movie. It's about a girl that just got out of jail, and she's tearing through Hollywood looking for her man because she found out that he cheated on her. But the girl is a sex worker and a transsexual sex worker. And I work for her guy, you know, and I like sell drugs for him for that department of his businesses. And it just takes you through all that life on Santa Monica that you drive by and that we don't pay attention to. It puts you in there. Like, it's raw, and it puts you in there. And they had this app on the iPhone developed by this tech company, and it made the thing look beautiful and raw, and the colors like blow at you. You can't even tell it was shot by iPhone. It's just a pretty incredible piece of film that got like good critical acclaim.
How much acting have you done?
I did some acting in college, like theater class, and I took an acting class in New York, and then I took like on and off for like 3 years. Was it 600 feet? Fuck, I should remember the name. But it was a good acting class. It's the type of acting class that's perfect for my style of me. You know what I'm saying? It just like it makes you like study the circumstances and conditions that you as a character is in and play them real. So then, and it simplifies everything for me. You know what I'm saying? So it's good for me. And so that's what I just use in the film.
Can you elaborate on that, since I don't have time to take that class?
Tell me. Like, the class was funny. Like, when I went to when you go to audit the class, it's free. They was like, it's $85. I was always offended because a friend told me about the class. I was like, I'm not auditing no class for $85. The balls of these people. And I was like, but I was so offended I went. You know? But she said, the reason why she charged is like, you could take everything from this class and never come back and use it in your life. And it was about connecting with the material. So we went through the class. She said, how do you think visually? She gave us like a test to figure out how do we think. And she said, you think visually and verbally, right? And then at the end of the class, we did this exercise in the class where you at the end of the class, we go outside and she gives us a script that fits all of us, right? And one of the reasons why I took acting classes is because my memory is appalling. I can't remember, no matter if I study for 3 hours, I go in that audition, I'm looking at the paper or I'm stumbling through. So then she gave us this scene and she said, you're going to read the scene, give you 20 minutes, you can come in and you're going to do the scene in front of me. I'm like, this bitch is crazy. This is not happening. So the process was, you read a line, right, in the script, and you spend some time with that line. You get visual pictures for that line, right? Then you read the next line, and you do the same thing. And you read the next line, and you do the same thing. You read the next line, and do the same thing, right? So now I go in there. It's only 20 minutes. Like, I've had more time to remember less and never succeeded. So I'm like, good luck, lady. So then we start doing the scene and I'm reading it. She takes it from me and puts the paper down, face down. And I'm like, so are we just going to stare at each other now? There's no way I remember what's on that paper. And she's like, use your visualization. So then I see the first thing that I'd visualized from the first line. And then I said the line. I saw the second thing, said the line. But I said it in the circumstances and the condition. I was like a sharecropper's son and I lived with my mother. My father was dead. I've seen her raped and the shit that's happened. But every line I read, I made a picture for in my head. So I just talked about the pictures and it was sad and I was trying to remember and it was just like somebody really trying to remember something in a scene. It looked like I'm trying to remember. And I was like, oh shit, I gotta take this class. You know, because it worked. You know, it really worked.
And that was here in LA?
It was here in LA, yeah. It's like actually like on San Vicente.
How long did you take the class for?
On and off for like 3 or 4 years. On and off. Like I never went completely through, but it's a really good class. Let's see if I can remember something 100 feet. Something. I can see. I didn't visualize it. But it's on San Vicente. Really good. Steve Treesort was my teacher. I can't remember the name of the chick. It's not a chick, she's a grown woman. But you know, it's a good class.
Best thing I ever heard in an acting class was acting is just like real life.
Right.
You need to look people in the eye when you speak to them, mm-hmm. and listen. And
right.
You know, when you look people in the eye when you speak, the words come out of your mouth more naturally. And I do that as a comedian as well. Like when I'm on stage, I look everyone in the eye, mm-hmm. in the audience. When I was younger and I was terrified, I would look over their heads, right. And you can tell when a young comedian's looking over their heads right. and or nodding their down. Eyes because it sounds like they're, you know, reciting some shit they memorized.
Right, right.
Instead of speaking.
Yeah. Like, what was it? Last night I had a show. Sometimes shows are funny. Like, last night I had a show at the store, and I connected with that audience so well. And it's weird to say that because I've been doing comedy a minute. So to say, like, what was the difference between that crowd and all the other crowds if I'm, say, a good comic? It was just some nights you could feel the connection that you're doing your job of connecting better than others. And last night was one of them. And it reminds me about all the times that when I did good, but I was like, oh, shit, it makes me realize I didn't connect. You know, but last night, we like it was a small group in the OR, in the store, and we had a good time together. Like, I was leaving some, it was like leaving some friends when it was time to get off stage.
Wow.
Like, we connected, man, like from word one.
I used to avoid the Comedy Store.
Uh-huh.
I thought it had a bad energy.
It does.
Used to.
Yeah.
They defumigated the place.
They did something.
They did something.
Yeah.
And it's magical now.
Right.
And I was there 2 weeks ago, and, you know, Judd Apatow was there, Mark Maron, mm-hmm. Rogan, Joey Diaz. And it's like, that's what we were talking about before we started recording. Like, the great thing for me about being in LA is getting to see all these great comedians and be on the same show. Right. And then that makes you raise your game.
Right.
When you're on the road and you're the headliner,
you're killing.
You know, it's great being the man,
right.
But you're not, you know, exposed to people doing their top level work.
Right, right.
So the Comedy Store is having a renaissance right now.
And hats off to you to jump in the comedy gladiator ring and be like, want to be, you know, raw. Like, you got some stuff established, but that's, you know, it's not easy. Like, I don't know if I could do that if I wasn't already in it.
What's that?
Like I was talking to Joey Diaz, and Joey Diaz is a crazy guy.
Yeah.
He's wild. The last thing you'd expect for him is to have any fear, and he's telling me how the store has made him better. He's like, just by watching it and like going in, having to bring your A game, and it's making perk up, and it's even at times. Now he's fine, but when he first started going back there, it made the level of competition made him nervous. You know what I'm saying? And if I wasn't in it, and I wanted to get in it, like, my pride would be like, I don't want to look bad. I'll just keep doing what I'm doing, and not deal with this, you know. But, you know, but just to learn something over again, or just to say, all right, I got to step my game up, you know, it's a big thing to admit, you know. But it's a man thing to admit.
You know what I mean? Joey, who I love, and it's great how he is just like exploding
right
now. And he has the audience he deserves, you know, and he's selling places out all over the country. And, you know, he's a hard-hitting comedian any way you want to slice it.
Right.
I listened to his podcast a month or two ago. I forget the guy who he had on, but it was some comedian who had been in prison a lot. And so they were both talking about their prison experiences. And they were talking about how to survive in prison.
Hilarious.
And, like, you know, how to, you know, you walk in looking hard,
right,
and, like, you know, never show fear. And if somebody, like, challenges you, you fight them instantly,
right,
and all this shit. And he's talking about making weapons out of shit. And, you know, I've never committed any felonies. All my crimes have been misdemeanors.
Uh-huh.
But I'm listening to this podcast going, oh, man, I need to remember this shit.
Excellent. but you need to remember that shit.
It's like shit you would never ever need in your life.
It's hilarious. You need to remember that shit on the outside, man. Like, to me, life is jail.
Really?
You know what I'm saying? Like, I think somebody's always trying to fuck you, and you always got to keep a shank. And I think you got to walk down. There's nicer jails. Like, there's country clubs and shit like this. So this is the country club outside, but life is jail, man.
You think life is jail, really?
Yeah, that's what I think. Like,
life, so you got to, like, Sean Penn in Bad Boys, you got to have the pillowcase and the cans of Coke ready?
Yeah, like I don't naturally meet a lot of people because I don't have a smile on my face. Because I'm not a big dude. When I was a kid on Long Island, we used to get the news. The news would be from Manhattan, and there was nothing but fives in the Bronx every night, or somebody getting pushed onto a train or robbed in New York City. So when I had to start doing comedy in New York City, I had my game face. I walked into New York City like I was walking into jail. You know what I'm saying? And I never got robbed all the times I've been in the city. Like, and I'm not a big dude. Like, and I realized that even though I don't live there anymore, I still got that look. Like, I'm not the most approachable person. You know, and I have to, you know, you can make friends with a smile. Sometimes strangers come up to you, hey man, what's wrong? You know something's up with your face. When three times a week, a stranger says, hey man, what's wrong? Or somebody just gets out the elevator, not on their floor. Like, I think I'm less like that now, but I was like a lot like that. And I wasn't trying to fight anybody. I just didn't want anybody to fuck with me. You know what I'm saying?
Well, I remember New York in the 80s
was
really dangerous.
Yeah, man.
And I lived in Washington Heights in 1989 as crack was coming to the neighborhood. Uh-huh. I mean, there was all kinds of parts in New York where you didn't want to go.
Yeah.
And I think it's remarkable now you go to New York and you see people like talking on their cell phones, expensive iPhones, and wearing jewelry. And like in the late 80s when I lived there, people would turn their rings in or like take off jewelry.
Right,
like
right.
You would never show anything of $20 value or more on the subway train, or else you'd get robbed.
Yeah, corporations want to turn it into a tourist spot, so they clean it up, you know. And the mayor and everybody, you know, back then and after, just went with it. So it's good. Like, you know, remember how Times Square used to look compared to now?
Yeah.
Like, it's funny, it happened so slowly, and I was there, and then one day I looked up and said, oh shit, this is like Disneyland.
Yeah.
This is not, no, maybe I'd moved here or something. I don't know, I can't remember exactly when it was happening before I left, but, and I went back a few times, and then one day I just looked at Times Square, and I was like, this is different. Like, this shit has changed.
And they're doing that with Hollywood Boulevard, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Where that used to be really gritty and,
and
junkies
yeah.
and prostitutes, and now it's kind of cleaned up.
Where are the poor junkies and prostitutes going to go? They went downtown and then they cleaned up downtown. I'm going to see wherever junkies and prostitutes move to and buy property there. Because that's the next neighborhood that they're going to fix up next.
What about acting? What do you think would be the ideal acting role for you?
I got a show idea. I think that would be a great idea, a good role. Or just... You know when I'm funny? Like, here's the funny thing. It's tough for me to audition, or because I'm black and they're used to a certain style of black guy. They want you to go in there and pop them with energy. Every time, even when I, like, could you do that with more energy? It's like, nobody trusts that when somebody will see me do things the way I do it on stage, that it'll be funny. They're just so conditioned to seeing black guys with energy, you know? So that has always been a problem. So it's always better to just do something in my own, you know, that do something that's my own vehicle, you know what I mean? And I'm good when I play things serious, because if the scenario's funny, then the jokes will come out fine. I don't have to, have you ever seen some actors try to put on that funny thing? Like, if I'm passionate in the moment, whether I'm playing it low-key or I'm depressed or happy about something, then it's funny. So anything that's just real, and I'm good at drama too. Like, I don't want to just be it to be just a comedy thing, you know? I like a mixture.
How's everybody feeling? Good, I like that. You look like an honest crowd, so I just want to take a quick survey. Say you're walking down the street late at night, and you see two black dudes in hoodies coming your way. How many people here honestly would cross over to the other side of the street? So one person in the top and me. That's it. The rest of y'all just being straight dishonest, huh? All right, let me tell you why I'd cross street. I'd cross street because the news tells me every night that black dudes in hoodies are dangerous. There is a black dude in a hoodie story on the news every night, no matter what's going on in the world. And back from Afghanistan to these black dudes in hoodies. Oh, I wish I was safely in war-torn Afghanistan, away from these black dudes in hoodies. Like, the news make it so bad, I seen a black dude in a hoodie cross the street when he seen another black dude in a hoodie. Hey man, I don't want no problems, player. I don't want none either, bruh. Grandma, is that you? Because the news tell us what to think about all the different races. They set the stereotypes every night. But what the news doesn't tell us is that men in suits are the biggest robbers and the biggest criminals. Yeah. Hands down. You know what I'm saying? Like, Bernie Madoff was one dude in a suit. He stole more money than every black dude in the history of hoodies combined. You know what I'm saying? He stole $65 billion. Black dudes in hoodies ain't mugged a million yet. Like, one dude in a suit outstole an entire race. Like, next time you walk down the street and you see a man in a suit, cross over and warn the black dude in a hoodie. He's in danger. Save his life. Do something. And that's why I'm glad Obama's the president, because finally, black people have a good representative. You know what I'm saying? Before, we had some bad black representatives. We have Al Sharpton. Al Sharpton is not a good look for black people. No, he'll come on the news, and people are like, hey man, there goes your leader. I'm like, I didn't nominate this dude my leader. You know what it feels like to have Al Sharpton as your leader? White people, imagine if Hulk Hogan was your racial leader. Every time something goes down, he comes on the news. Ah! You know me and Gene, we're going to shut this racism down. Like, why is our leader ripping off his shirt? Kissing his muscles. Before that, we had Jesse Jackson. A lot of people think Jesse Jackson is a good leader, but Jesse Jackson is not a good leader. This is how you know Jesse Jackson is not a good leader, because nobody ever tried to kill him. You know what I'm saying? It is disrespectful to have a black leader that nobody wants to kill, you know? This is how you know Jesse Jackson was really not a good leader. The person who shot Martin Luther King had a clear shot at Jesse Jackson, too. And that dude just packed up his rifle and went home, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, he's gonna do more damage alive. Let's just get out of here. Now, I was watching the news, I saw the story about this guy. He did 30 years in jail for something he didn't do, and they finally found out and let him out. And I was happy for him. But let me tell you something. If I do 30 years in jail for something I didn't do, when I get out, I'm gonna do something. That's 30 years credit, you know? I've already done the time, now it's time to do the crime. Feel me? I got a prepaid crime credit card. I'm just gonna commit crimes and swipe. Doop! Yes, officer, excuse me, talk to me. Get the hell out of my face, officer. I'll be back in court the next day. The judge will be looking at me like, Mr. Edwards, it says here, we let you out yesterday and you just robbed the gas station with an ice pick. I'm like, that's right, sir. That's a year. Take it off my card and hurry up. I got a lot more stuff I got to do. I got banks to rob and drugs to sell. As a matter of fact, I don't like the way you're looking at me, judge. Get the hell out of here. It's 5 years. Take it off my card. And don't let me use the rest of it up in this court. All right, that's my time. My name is Ian Edwards. Peace,
y'all. Well, you're kind of a Renaissance man because the other area where you've excelled is in writing.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're always working as a writer. Mm-hmm. And I think that is probably one of the most difficult areas of comedy entertainment to thrive in. So what's the secret to your success? What's the secret sauce?
Oh, to the writing, it's...
Is it as fulfilling
it's fulfilling. I would just wish, like, it'll be fulfilling. It's on the way to be fulfilling. It's not that it's not fulfilling. Like, I get to stay in LA and I get to work in LA and I get to be in the game. But I would love to get an award and work on a show that blows up and everybody respects it, because then it'll help me to always get the work I want to get. So I'm working towards that, you know, like I've done some good sitcoms recently. Like, I was on Blackish, then I left that. But the
Why would you leave a good writing job like that? Wasn't black enough?
Yeah, it wasn't black enough. Nah. Sometimes I'm torn between stand-up and writing, you know? And then if I'm not being fulfilled in every way in that writing job, then I'll be like, why do that when I can just go do stand-up? At least I can do everything I want to do. Plus, in stand-up, I don't think I've done everything I can do in stand-up. So then if the writing job is lacking in some areas, I'm like, fuck it, just this time, for real, go focus on your stand-up. And get everything you can get out of it before it's too late. But I'm in a situation now where I can go back and forth. Like people will call me for jobs because I guess I kind of have a reputation. And
yeah, you're prolific and you deliver.
Right, I deliver and I'm a hard worker. And then comics get their own show and they've always seen me in the club. Like, the comedy club has always been a good place for me to get writing jobs, because then comics there, they end up on shows, or they know somebody on the shows, they say, call that guy. So stand-up has helped me get probably 60% of my writing jobs, you know, because people see me there. And then the last show I just wrote on was the Carmichael show. I don't know when this goes up, but the last two, it's a summer
Jared Carmichael, that show?
Yeah, Jared Carmichael show, yeah. It's supposed to be a summer burn-off, but the ratings are good and it's getting critical acclaim. And I like the direction of the show. And in the last two episodes are on tonight, Wednesday night, you know, like 9 and 10, something like that, on NBC. So, you know, maybe that'll go and we'll see what's up.
And then you would stay writing on that show?
Yeah, because I think everything is right over there. It's the right type of show. It has a chance to say some things. Like, they got episodes about guns, transgender, and they're not pulling any punches on it. Like, all the characters are... like, say if you watched a panel show and everybody had a different voice on the panel show about a topic, like, just imagine a panel show played out by sitcom characters, like, voicing their opinion on shit that's going on right now. We had a protest episode about the riots, we had a gun episode, we got a transgender episode, and we got just like button issues, you know. And they go there on the show. So I like the future of that, the potential for the future of a show like that.
And it's a sitcom.
It's
talking about all this.
It's talking about all this stuff. Yeah.
Pertinent.
Yeah.
Historical events.
Yeah.
Of the now.
Of the now, yeah. Wow. And that's how fucked up the world is. It hasn't changed. Yeah, a sitcom could do that. Like, even if you shoot it months ahead of time, that topic's still relevant because we on Earth are idiots.
Yeah. Well, and it just seems like, I don't know, I think that people expected, you know, having the first black president, things would be a little different now. It seems
I
like...
I was wrong as shit about that.
I was wrong as shit as well. Yeah. I thought, oh my God, this big change. And
this is it.
And you know what, you always heard...
You did
it. You always heard the term, I haven't heard it in the past year, but post-racial. Mm-hmm. You always heard that term a lot about 4 or 5 years ago. Yeah, we're living in the post-racial America where, like, you know, race doesn't matter anymore. Right. But it seems like now things are worse than they've ever been.
It's on and popping. But it's all the perspective of the media. Things are better, but a lot of shit are still the same. And it's almost as if racist people are like, whoa, 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 we're still here, you know, like, proudly. It's hilarious.
Well, it seems like the Donald Trump... has given white people racist white people, like New Hope for America. Like he's the
Donald Trump.
He's the Obama of
racism.
Of racism.
And the sad thing about the crazy thing about Donald Trump, he's not as racist as the people who want to vote for him to be president.
Right. Yeah. I guess like the way liberal people were disappointed in Obama for being because he wasn't that liberal. I mean, like he was a pretty like you know center guy. He wasn't like real radical.
But also he couldn't be like he did a slick thing. He went on the Marc Maron podcast.
Yeah, it was smooth.
It was smooth, and he basically gave out his resume for his whole presidency and explained to people how politics work. Sometimes you move things a degree and you wait till the other person to come after you and move it a degree more. But you have to get the shit started. So that's like people thought he's gonna like revolutionize healthcare. Nah, you'll start it and then somebody else will keep moving it along until finally it's perfect one day. But you're not gonna win the whole thing.
And I thought that was really powerful that he went on Maron, and it made me fall in love with Obama again, because one of the things I was disappointed in him was that he couldn't change the gun laws after Sandy Hook. And he talked about that. He said that was the first time in my presidency where I felt disgusted because they wouldn't let him, you know, change the gun laws one iota.
Right.
And then also it was the week after, less than a week after the Charleston shooting. And I thought it was like a really, for me anyway, it was a really healing moment in America. And I actually, and that was another repercussion from that Charleston thing. And, you know, I realized that, you know, my political party is my family. And they mean more to me than my political party. And I told my brother that. And then he doesn't feel that way. The Republican Party is more important to him than...
Oh, for real. Sorry.
Than any epiphanies I may have
had. That's hilarious. That's hilarious. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Like, I'm torn on this gun law thing. Like, I don't know. This is why I don't want the gun laws to change, because I don't trust our police and the powers that be. And one day, some shit might go down, and I need people to be armed for it. You know, because just based on the shit that they're doing in the news right now, I don't trust. So that's why I don't. But at the same time, I know the countries that don't, the weapons aren't like just all over the place. It's not easy to get a gun. There's less crime. So torn about that. But I don't. Imagine what the leaders of this country would do if people didn't have guns. Like, look at all the shit that they're doing now. You know, like, I don't trust a world like that. You know what I'm saying? So, I'm torn.
Like, that they would really feel like they could do whatever they wanted.
Yeah, yeah. And it's like...
But even if you change the gun laws, you're still never going to... There's still so many guns out there.
Yeah.
They're never going to... We'll never live in a world without guns.
You'll never live in a world without guns. There's so many guns out there. And they want to change... the gun laws, that ain't gonna do shit. Like, there's so many, like, in the hood, those people get guns every day. How is it changing and none of them are bought in a gun shop.
Right.
Like, how is changing the gun law really gonna change anything? You know what I mean? Like, when it comes down to it. Like, when people are committing crimes, they don't go out and get legal guns. They get an illegal one. So, the gun law thing to me is like, it's like the trying to Republicans bringing up abortion during an election. It's like, you're just trying to sound like a Republican. You ain't really going to try and stop it. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just talking points.
Do you own a gun?
No.
Oh, did you see what Prince said? It was in the newspaper. Prince just came out with a new album that's only available on some other streaming site. Uh-huh. But he was talking about the police, and he said that they were originally slave catchers.
Well, they're like, to us, to like black people, they're like overseers. Like, they're just a continuation of like overseers during slavery.
Yeah.
And just because, you know, our relationship with them, you know, hasn't been that great. You know, like, So I get why he would say that.
Did you see, what was that story? Some woman had an artificial insemination earlier this year.
And that's hilarious.
It was.
No, this is going.
Turns out that it was a black sperm donor.
Uh-huh.
And she was upset about it.
And she wanted to sue.
Yeah.
And I think she lost the lawsuit or something like that.
She should. I think if you're desperate to have a kid and you're a sperm donor, yeah. I mean, you should get whatever good sperm is out there.
Yeah. Listen, you're going to be a mother. You can't go to court against the people who gave you a black baby, because that baby is going to grow up to see that you went to court against her having you. How is that kid supposed to feel? Like, you don't have to take that. I think it's good for that lady. She'll learn to love that kid, hopefully, and it'll change her life and her point of view.
It reminds me of something my father used to say to us, the children in our family. He said, mm-hmm. I don't care who you marry, mm-hmm. as long as they're tall.
That's hilarious.
Because I'm tired of watching our family sit on the bench.
That's hilarious. hilarious.
Here's it's show and tell from, I've had everything in storage for 10 years, uh-huh. and I found these old copies of, I don't know why, the I was never a big comic book guy, but I read Captain America when I was a little kid.
Me too, yeah.
And he had this, I think this is, he had this black superhero friend named the Falcon. Uh-huh. Do you remember this guy?
Barely, because I don't remember comic books as well as the people who remember comic books now. It amazes me that... Or people can tell you, like, details of episodes of cartoons. I'm like, yeah. How the fuck do you remember that shit? Like, I watched them all. I read comic books relentlessly when I was a kid. But when it was time to put it down, I just shoved the memory of all that stuff aside. But I do remember Falcon.
I put this down. I remember I got over. I didn't have a long comic book period because I got into comedy at 12.
Damn.
And then, so this is, like, maybe me around 10 or 11.
Mm-hmm.
And then I remember waking up one day thinking, Captain America is like the lamest superhero ever. He can't fly.
Uh-huh.
He only had his shield.
Right.
And then in these comic... And then... So this is like... This is 1976. And see, the Falcon has got kind of like a Commodore's Live outfit on.
Hilarious.
Some kind of P-Funk looking...
It's Coco Beware.
It's Coco Beware. And Captain America would be getting his ass whooped...
Mm-hmm.
And then the Falcon would come in and save him. So like the Falcon would only be on like two pages.
That's hilarious.
See, this was
Captain America getting trouble.
The Abraham Lincoln statue turns evil and fights Captain America.
Damn, that's bananas.
Isn't that crazy?
That's crazy.
And then the Falcon has to come in and
for some reason
kick the Abraham Lincoln statue's ass.
Like, these comic book people, That's some bananas, weed smoking shit. That's a crazy idea. It's dope.
The other thing I think is supremely interesting about you, mm-hmm. And is that you're a soccer fanatic.
Right.
And that you have your
soccer comic rant. Yeah.
Soccer comic rant.
Mm-hmm.
Is that your Jamaican origin that you got into soccer?
That's the English and the Jamaican.
Yeah.
That's the first thing I ever wanted to be was a soccer player. But I think I was too slow, you know, and I think when I was growing up in Jamaica, they didn't have there was no way to get to professional leagues, and when I moved to America, they definitely didn't have a league then. And so I played a little bit in college, but I just wasn't in the structure and all that stuff that they have now wasn't there. And but I always loved it. It's the only thing that makes me not quit comedy. Like, I kind of quit soccer out of anger. Like, I played in college, and the first year I tried to be a walk-on on the team. I said, maybe I can get a scholarship. Then I didn't make the team. In the second year, I felt like I should have made the team. Even the assistant coach was like, you should make this team. And then they didn't put me on the first away game. And then I just quit in anger. And then later on, when I realized I shouldn't have done that. So in comedy, I was like, I'll never quit comedy. You know, because if I had continued in soccer, I could have did something. I could have made it to at least like the first set of MLS teams. You know what I'm saying? So that's why I never quit comedy. And
you don't think you could make it on some of these teams now?
Too old. Too old. They're too fast.
Help me with this. Mm-hmm. Tell me if I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. Bob Marley loved soccer.
Yeah.
He got an injury on his toe from playing soccer.
Right.
And that led to the cancer that killed him.
Right. That's what they say, yeah.
Is that true?
Yeah.
So basically he was killed by the thing that he loved. Am I right?
Yeah, there's a way you can put it like that. But then there's other conspiracies and shit. But
it was political parties in Jamaica.
That he was injected with something that killed him. Probably injected the cancer. They don't believe it. But, I don't know. I'll go with the soccer cancer toe theory.
Who's your favorite soccer team?
Manchester United in England. And I root for Real Madrid in Spain.
Nice.
Yeah, yeah. And you got that Barcelona clock over there.
Yeah.
The Barcelona alarm clock.
Yeah. I was in England last year, and somebody took me to see Arsenal play Liverpool
at
the Emirates Stadium.
Right.
And it was fantastic. And then I've seen a few matches in Argentina. I grew up in Orlando. I'm mm-hmm. thrilled that they have the Orlando City Lions now. Uh-huh. I've went to a couple matches this year.
Oh, you did? Sure.
And, they got Kaká from Brazil. And they're getting a little old. He's getting a little older now, mm-hmm. Which is why he's not on the Brazilian national team.
They actually played him this week. That's how, Brazil is desperate.
Brazil handed the United States its ass?
Yeah.
Kaká was on that team?
I think he played on that game and he played another one this week. Because this week was international week. So then, all the best players go to represent their country and play either in friendlies or, how do I put this? In the qualifying games in their, confederation group. So I think he definitely played for Brazil this week.
Well, I know that the...
He's like a guy that's... He's old... But he's good, so they put him on the squad sometimes, and then sometimes they don't select him.
Right, because he wasn't even on the last World Cup.
Right, right.
So I thought he was done in Brazil.
Yeah, yeah. There's times when he's done, but he's still young enough to
So that's strange. They would bring him on for a cameo appearance.
Right, because Brazil doesn't have the quality of players that they normally usually have. It's just they're not that team anymore. They have some really good players, and then the rest of them is just like a drop off. So Kaká, who's one time he was the World Player of the Year, they'll try him.
There's a I actually bought it in Malaysia. I don't know where it was made, but it's 100 year history of the beautiful game, mm-hmm. and it's got it broken down by countries, mm-hmm. and the Brazilian soccer team. Solved a lot of their racial issues. Brazil, they don't have racial problems. There was a black goalie in I think the 30s or 40s that mm-hmm. lost one of the World Cups for them, mm-hmm. and then so they kind of blamed him, and then they got over that, and then it was the best players were of every ethnicity,
right?
And that particular video. It's like a 10 DVD set. Oh, it's right. Fantastic.
I gotta bar that or burn it or try to get that shit myself. I wouldn't lend it.
It's great. And then the one on Africa's fantastic. I forget who the first African country to play in a World Cup was, but they got destroyed 8-0.
I should be able to tell you that.
I think it was Ghana.
I don't remember.
And they go back to Ghana and nobody met him at the airport and all the players, they're old men. On the documentary, and they're like, yeah, they should have met us at the airport. We were the first team from Africa. And it's just fascinating. And then they talk about, how it's developing in Asia now. Mm-hmm. And it's an incredible. Did you see the two Escobars?
Yeah, that was one of the best documentaries I've ever seen. And I, you know, when I say that, I always ask myself, am I saying that because it was a soccer documentary? But no, that was a dope ass. It's a, and then when you see, and it was a 30 for 30, and when you see other 30 for 30s, they're not as good. They pale in comparison. That's a great documentary.
What do you mean 30 for 30?
It was one of those ESPN 30 for 30 documentaries.
Oh.
Yeah, like ESPN made it. It's dope, man.
Yeah, and they're hanging out with Pablo Escobar, going to visit him in the prison.
Right.
And then the goalie, he gets kicked off the team right before they go to the World Cup.
Yeah.
So everybody, that guy that had the own goal that they killed, whose last name was also Escobar.
Right.
So all these other players on that Colombian team were doing drugs, and they're hanging out at parties with Pablo Escobar, where this other Escobar, he was like a good Catholic kid, and he was really like a wholesome hero of the team. And then he scores the own goal,
right,
and then he goes back to Colombia, and they killed him.
Right. And he got into it with two, like, cartel killers.
In a bar. Like, he shouldn't have gone out.
And they mentioned that, but that's not why they killed him. You know, I think they mentioned that shit to Ashley, but, you know, fuck it. Died. He's gone, but that's a crazy documentary. I recommend anybody watch that.
Yeah.
Whether you're into soccer or not.
Yeah, yeah. I loved it.
It's funny, I was just watching, like, they have a show on Netflix now about Pablo Escobar. It's a series. And it's like, Pablo Escobar's crazy. They put him in prison in his palace. And the soccer team visited him there. He could have girls there. He could still do drugs there. He could still partially run his drug empire from there, and he would not stay there, and he escaped, and they had to make an example of him, and they found him, and they shot him. But the motherfucker could still be alive now in a palace in the mountains.
Yeah.
You know, there's people, like, there's people that don't try to escape from prison. You're in jail in a place you built. Like, what the hell's wrong with you?
Yeah, I think they even let him have some of his zoo animals.
Yeah.
Like, he had giraffes walking around, and he's in jail.
Yeah.
I'll and you got the jail. National soccer team coming to hang out with you and stuff.
So if you can have a soccer team come hang out with you, you could have whatever. Like, what the fuck is wrong with you? Why you got to leave?
That, in that documentary, the two Escobars, so the first game, and that was 94 when the World Cup was in the United States. So the goalie is kicked off the team right before they go.
Mm-hmm.
And so they blame the guy who had the own goal, and they killed him.
Mm-hmm.
But you had this replacement goalie. So I think it was really that goalie who got kicked off the team who should have been blamed primarily. But the opening match they played against Romania, and they show it in that documentary. This guy, it's like the first 2 minutes of the match, and this Romanian from, like, well, I guess like the 50-yard line or halfway on the pitch, kicks this monster rocket from halfway down the field, and it goes in. And then they're saying it on the documentary. They knew that, like, the ill winds had turned against them, and that it was going to be a long, ugly World Cup for them.
So that was a really good Colombian team too. Like, they were expected to do a lot, and I used to see, like, some of their players playing the Premiership or just different parts of the world, and they were good. And yeah, it's a complete disappointment for that Colombian team, and even more disappointing when the World Cup is still being played and you hear that one of the players got killed. Like, I wouldn't even go. If I'm a soccer player, I love soccer so much. If my team gets kicked out the World Cup, I'm staying in the country that is playing to see the rest of the World Cup and go to some of the games.
Yeah.
So, like, I was even shocked to know that the dude was back home, you know?
Yeah. Have you ever been to a World Cup?
Nah. I don't know why.
I would love to go, but the next one's in Russia.
Right. And who wants to go there?
I think they're having some strong anti-American sentiment there right now.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd like to. I should have went when in 94. I don't know why I didn't go to any games. It was dumb. I went to a big game after the World Cup when they had it was something versus the world. There was a game played at that stadium in Jersey, like where the Giants play. And I went there, like, right after the World Cup. I don't know why I didn't go to any of the games. I should have. And I wanted to go to Brazil this year.
Yeah.
But,
I did too. I heard it was...
Brazil's kind of dangerous, so I didn't fuck with it.
Oh, I would love to go to Brazil sometime. Yeah, me too. It took me living in Holland to really start to love soccer, and then going to England.
Right.
But when I went to Argentina and saw soccer matches, that is what, you know, made me really truly love the game.
Yeah.
And there's a new bit I've been working on about like, I saw River Plate play Quilmes, and the whole time the Argentinians are jumping up and down, you know?
Uh-huh.
They're just nonstop the whole time. And they're chanting at the other team the entire match. The other team was in the second league. Mm-hmm. So my cousin, Fernando, was translating for us.
Uh-huh.
Me and my brother, they were chanting to the other team, "You're in the second league. You'll always be in the second league." So the whole time they're like chanting these insults to the players on the other team. And I think we should use soccer chants in everyday life. You're really not qualified to work in a bank. You're too slow. The other tellers should help. This line is getting too long.
Yeah, you go to your bank. You go to Citibank wearing a Bank of America jersey and sing the chants at the tellers and shit on them. That's hilarious. That's funny as hell.
I think as long as referees from the third world, as long as people from the third world are allowed to referee, the United States will never win the World Cup.
That's hilarious.
What do you think?
they can win if they don't get a third world ref. But, like... I soccer's a huge sport, but there's some shady shit happening. Like, you know, sometimes players get paid and they do things, and sometimes top FIFA board members do things, and sometimes if you can make a player throw a game, you can make a ref throw a game. Like, you know, sometimes shady shit happens.
What do you think about the FIFA scandals?
Listen, they may have taken some bribes, right?
May have.
They may have taken
Qatar.
Some bribes. They may have taken some bribes. But all I know is I've gotten to see more soccer and enjoy more soccer ever since Sepp Blatter has been president of FIFA.
Really?
Like, he's brought it to the world. You know what I'm saying? He's brought it to the world. And who am I? A consumer of soccer, a guy who enjoys it, to judge a man. Like, that money was never going to be my money. Who did he take that? Who really did he... It's not like he stole that money and took it from poor people or something like that. Like, somebody said, "Hey, I want this tournament in my country. Here's some extra money to make sure it goes." All right. So whose country didn't get the World Cup? Like, countries don't even want the expense of a World Cup. So
yeah.
Fine.
What about the guy in Trinidad that was on the FIFA board?
He's probably dirty too.
Yeah, that they pointed him out as one of the dirtiest players.
I was shocked that somebody from Trinidad was on that high up the board. I was like, good for you. I was pretty amazed. At least he's not racist. Sepp Blatter will steal with anybody.
Who's your favorite team in the American League?
In the MLS, Galaxy.
Yeah?
Yeah. Because they're a well-run organization, and they're really trying to win. So I support an organization like that.
Great. I went to a Seattle Sounders game with Drew Carey and sat in his owner's box.
Oh, yeah?
That was pretty exciting.
I went to a Galaxy game and sat in his box. I don't know if he still has it, but it was before he owned
Sounders. Yeah, he got rid of that once he bought the Sounders. Right. That's amazing that you could buy your own professional sports team.
Right. Drew Carey got money like that. And I'm just happy that he's into soccer like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The guy from Cleveland.
The last guy that I'd expect to be into soccer. The round, chubby guy from Cleveland. Who's he on? The Price is Right? Not the Price. Is it
Price is Right? Yeah.
Yeah. The host of The Price is Right.
Yeah.
Owns a soccer team. Who would have thought that?
No, that's cooler than Bob Barker with his animal PETA. Right.
Way cooler.
So what has been the greatest advice you've ever been given as a comedian?
The greatest advice ever. I've had a lot of good advice, just so let me just think of the great Patrice O'Neill. This is not even a comedian advice. That's not comedian advice. I was gonna say, one bitch is too close to none. That's just some shit Patrice said. It's hilarious.
So you should have multiple women.
Yeah, that's, I guess that's what he was implying. He said you could do it, but just don't. Don't be shocked when she's gone if you realize you have none. It's basic. It's a piece of advice based on sound math from Maddox. It's hilarious. Comedy advice?
Or man advice, whatever you want to share.
Or man advice? Shit, why is this question so difficult? It's such a simple question. I don't know why, Tom. Can I phone this one back in? Can I text this answer to you?
You call me later.
Call you. Oh,
I thought of something.
Got some. I don't know. I've had a lot of good advice, but my memory's shitty these days. Yeah. Just work hard. Don't waste your time, you know. So this is the best piece of advice. My father was teaching me how to drive, right? And I failed the road test probably 3 times. So now he was teaching me how to drive. And I was backing up, and I was looking through the mirrors. And he said, look where you're going, you know, turn around and look in the direction you're going. And somehow I remembered that, but it never meant anything to me until he died. And for some reason, look where you're going stuck in my head. And I was like, oh, whether he meant it or not, that is not just driving advice. That is life advice. Like, if you want to go somewhere or accomplish a goal, look at where you're going, see what everything that's there, all the obstacles, and figure a way around them so you could get there in the fastest, most efficient, safest, quickest way. So look where you're going. You know, if you want to write a book, look where you're going. Like, figure out all the things you need to do to write a book. If you want to be an actor or do stand up, what's the quickest, fastest, efficient way? What's your plan? You know? So look where you're going.
That's great.
Yeah.
How long ago did your dad die in?
Like 2009.
My dad died in 2009 also.
Oh, shit, man.
Yeah, and it's funny you say it because like...
Conceived in Jamaica.
That's right.
And your dad died the same year as mine. That's crazy.
the brotherhood of convergence.
Yeah.
I think about things my dad said to me. Mm-hmm. Also, one time I was worried about something. I was going through a depression period. Mm-hmm. And he said, you got to find a way to be happy. Mm. He said, life goes by in an instant.
Yeah.
You know, just think about, like, just things that he said, you know, mm-hmm. Like that. It's funny when someone dies like that. Just mm-hmm. I know you, for me anyway, you kind of... becomes like an angelic figure, you know. My dad had a lot of problems and stuff, but he was a dispenser of wise, smart, and funny shit.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
I remember another piece of good advice is I had a roommate when I was living in the Valley. He was divorced, had 2 kids, wanted to pursue comedy, and that's a part of why he got divorced. He's in his 40s. It's like the wrong time to do it. So he's working in Vegas, come back to LA to take care of his kids, had a shitty car, had child support to pay, and just kid bills, and had to pay for a place in Vegas and pay for a place in LA so he could bring his kids to, or at least leave to go see his kids. And had his car broke down on a freeway from Vegas. And he's like, crumbling, you know, this is another expense. And the tow truck driver picked him up. He's like, his head, you know, he talked to the tow truck driver. He's telling him all his problems. And the tow truck driver, you know, looked like a look, was a man who'd been through life. Mm-hmm. He said, just put one foot in front of the other, brother. Just keep putting one foot in front of the other. And it's simple. It's like, that could apply to anything. It's like one step in front of the other. Just, that's true. You ain't going to solve all this shit today, but just one step, one step, one step, one step. That applies to writing a joke, writing a one-hour special, or just trying to get from here to the end of your career, anything. So that's another piece of good advice. Sometimes I just take advice outside of comedy and put it in comedy.
Yeah, no, like my dad was a salesman. He gave me like great advice, like shit that related from sales. Like they'll buy from a friend before they will a stranger. Mm-hmm. Like make friends with the audience first. Like I used to, when I was a young comedian, I'd go out and do some like hard shit up in front. And you know, it's okay to do that. Mm-hmm. Just do it at the end after you've already won them over.
Right.
You know, if they don't know who you are and you're coming out throwing some hard shit, it's not going to work.
Yeah.
And my mom, one time she was taking tennis lessons. And I asked her, how's the tennis lessons going, Mom? Mm-hmm. And she said, okay, honey, I think the secret is never get frazzled and smack the shit out of the big ones. And I think that's perfect comedy
advice.
That's
hilarious.
Never get frazzled and smack the shit out of the big ones.
That's funny. That's hilarious. I'll use that.
Do you have any advice for me, your friend, on moving to Los Angeles?
Enjoy it.
Okay.
Simple, just enjoy it. Like, I think you've picked the perfect place with the perfect surroundings and the perfect atmosphere. So why not maximize the enjoyment of this shit? You're close to the store, you're close to all the things that are places I like to go to, your walking distance. Like, you're set up for enjoyment, so fucking enjoy it, man.
Good. Yeah. Ian, I love you to death, my brother.
Same here, man.
In closing, is there any words of wisdom or advice you'd like to give to the people of the earth?
It's corny, but it's true. Just love each other. Let's take care of each other. And like, this is, all this shit is nothing. You know, like, what's the meaning of life? Nothing. And if we all saw it as nothing, then a lot of shit that mean a lot of shit to us and that get us in trouble wouldn't. And we just care about each other. And we just don't care about shit that doesn't matter. Just care about each other and we're good.
How's that going to work in a country where we're so divided and pitted against each other?
It's just work. It's as hard as forgiving. It's as hard as forgiving, man. You know, it's not easy advice to follow, but if we did, we'd be better.
Great. Yeah.
Enjoy and laugh.
But, all right, man. Well, it's always inspirational and wonderful to see you, man. So
man, my pleasure, Tom, man.
Long may you run, brother.
Thanks, man. It's great to be in your new spot, man. This is dope.
You're one of my first guests.
Thank you, man.
Thanks for being here.
All right.
Baby, I really, really love you now. I think you should stop your crying. Here's my kerchief to dry your eyes. You know that I love you, hey, Ruby. Here I am, come and rub it by me belly like a guava jelly. Damsel, here I stand, come rub it by my belly like a guava jelly. Strain, this train is bound to glory. This train, talking about my, this train is bound to glory. This train, this train is bound to glory. This train carry no one holy. This train, I'm a talking about this train. When I was just a kid, my mommy used to sing this song. Now I've grown to be a man. Well, it still lingers deep down in my soul. I said it lingers deep down here in my soul. I'm talking about this train is bound to glory. This train is bound to glory. This train. This train is bound to glory. Oh, this here train carrying oh and holy. This train. I'm a talking about this train. The stone that the builder refused will always be the head cornerstone. The stone that the builder refused will always be the head cornerstone. You're a builder, baby. Here I am, a stone. Don't you pick and refuse me, 'cause the things people refuse are the things they should choose. Do you hear me? Hear what I say. Stone that the builder refuse will always be the head cornerstone. Stone that the builder refuse, yeah, will always be the head cornerstone. You're a builder, baby. Whoa, here I am, a stone. Don't you pick and refuse me, 'cause the things people refuse are the things they should use. The things people refuse are the things they should use. Do you hear me? Hear what I say. Stone that the builder refuse will always be the head cornerstone. The stone that the builder refuse will always be the head cornerstone. Come, come, come back here, my young lady. Come, come, come back here to me, my young lady. Yeah. Just while I thought everything was running smooth, left me while I was in the mood. Now I'm calling to you, 'cause my world is relying for you to come, come, come back here, my young lady. Come, come, come back here to me, my young lady. Just while I thought everything was running smooth. See that one now. Searching the whole darn day for a little woman of mine, 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 mine. Someone told me I could find her here, but it seems she disappeared. Said I searched the whole darn day, night is drawing nigh. I think I'd better go home, try tomorrow again. But when I reach that railroad station, I miss the last train. and then it seemed like dewdrops gonna fall on me. Yes, it seemed like teardrops gonna call on me now. I said I better make up my mind. What am I gonna do? Am I gonna rest up here? Or am I gonna push on through? My mind said, hey man, you hit the road. Down there I miss the track. I'm lost, Lord, I'm lost. Love is such a heavy load. And then for crying out loud, come back to me. For crying out loud, hear my plea. For crying out loud, come back to me. Why do you treat me so bad? Why do you treat me so bad? Bam, 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 boom. Let's stir it up. Stir it up, little darling, stir it up. You have that? Little darling, stir it up. Little darling, it's been a long, long time since I've got you on my mind. Now you are here, it's so clear to see what we could do, just you and me. Yeah, let's stir it up, little darling, stir it up. Oh, come on, woman. Little darling, come on, stir in a dry tenor. Little darling, I'll push the wood, blaze the fire, satisfy your heart desire. I'll stir it, yeah, every minute, yeah. All you got to do, honey, keep it in it, let's stir it up. Little darling, let's stir it up. Little darling, stir it up. Whoa, 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 darling. Just a little child, happiness was there a while. Then from me it slipped one day. Happiness, come back, I say, 'cause if you don't come, gonna go looking, yeah, for happiness. 'Cause if you don't come, gonna go looking now for happiness. Been together like school children, then your hurt was just in vain.